Thank you. fire. In an emergency, please exit quickly and quietly. Regarding this event, please note the following. Smoking is not permitted in the auditorium or throughout the building. Please disable all cell phones, beepers, or other electronic devices. Food and beverages are not permitted. The use of cameras and recording equipment is strictly prohibited in the auditorium. Thank you for your cooperation. Enjoy the program.
Thank you. Give us our champion. So this next, let's see, who we have up here? Well, that is, oh, that's Tommy Dorsey and Jimmy Dorsey. You know what? Jimmy Dorsey's the saxophone player. Maynard used to play with him, not Tommy. We're going to do a piece by Tommy later. But there he goes, who's next? There he is, Glenn Miller. Yeah, so, okay. So this is a piece that's famous amongst jazz players, and it's associated with Joe Henderson. A great saxophonist, writes a lot of great tunes. This is modern. This is what we just heard was a bebop tune. And after bebop came what they call hard bop and fusion. And this is from that era, right after bebop. He's a great player. There's some photos up there, but that's not him. And a saxophone. And this is an arrangement by Hayden Williams, who's I think he's a freshman. Are you a freshman? Man. I feel like I've been here forever. I thought, you're a freshman. You know, it seems like 4 years. And Aiden wrote this chart. He was going to write a chart for the band. I said, yeah, and he wrote it. This is his first chart for the band, and it's of Joe Henderson's tune, Recorder Man, and it features Tim on tenor saxophone. Here's Recorder Man. Thank you. Wayne Shorter. Yeah, nice first. Nice first chart. Milt Jackson, great vibraphonist. You didn't have too many of them. You had Lionel Hampton, Terry Gibbs, Gary Burton, and Milt Jackson. Maybe you could fill up one hand with the people who were the famous vibraphone players, but it was a great instrument. It was kind of a funny instrument. It came from the orchestra, and no one knew how to make it work, so it took Lionel Hampton to bring that instrument into jazz. And what was funny about this jazz and different instruments is it started from like Dixieland, so clarinet and trumpet and trombone kind of had a home in jazz right away. But later on, people would play jazz violin, and we had jazz harp and jazz vibraphone, and it was usually somebody who was able to do that. They picked a particular instrument and they were able to successfully bring it into jazz, and that was interesting. And Milt Jackson's thing was that he brought the vibraphone into the bebop era. So he wrote this tune called Bag's Groove, and this will feature Chris, Kyle, Dave, and John. And well, you'll see them all, but it's Bag's Groove. John on trombone, and our special guest, we're going to feature him on this too, he'll be out a little bit later, but he was my roommate on the road when we were traveling with Maynard Ferguson. He's Grammy nominated, he's a great arranger, a great trombonist, a great teacher, and all around good guy. We've been working with the bands the last 3 days, and everybody's fallen in love with his crazy antics. We really didn't get in trouble a lot, but enough. And we thought it would be great to have him come out. Please welcome. He teaches out in Denver. He used to conduct the North Texas State Jazz Band, and he's done a million things. Welcome, Steve Wiest.
Thank you.
We have a John Hart major now. Okay. So, this year is our first year we did a redesign in the jazz major, and this year is our first year having a jazz guitar ensemble led by our jazz guitar professor, Brian Betts. And, And this is something new. If you're a guitar, if you're a jazz major and you play guitar, you can play in a small group, and you can play, like, one guitar is usually in a big band. A lot of big bands don't even have guitars, so, you know, we're lucky to have the program so we can include a guitar in the band. But when you have enough guitar players, you can have a jazz guitar ensemble, and you can do all kinds of things. It's a unique group, and it's kind of different, and we thought it would be great to see who we're up to now. Oh, that's Joe Henderson. That's the guy who wrote Recorded By, Joe Henderson. Passed away, he was great. Anyway, so every guitar player who plays jazz, at some point they've dealt with Wes Montgomery. Wes Montgomery is the father of modern jazz guitar. And not only did he write great, but he played great, but one of the characteristics of Wes is that he didn't use a pick. Guitar players use a pick. You guys all have picks? Hold up your picks. Picks? Okay, see, they all hold picks. Wes did not have a pick. Wes had a big callus. He played with his thumb, and he had a callus on his thumb. It looked like half, if you had a marble and you cut it in half and you put it on his thumb, he had a big callus, and that's what he used. And because of that, he got this warm sound that everybody loves. But we're using picks these days, but Wes had this great sound from using his thumbs. If you just YouTube Wes Montgomery, you'll see him playing without a pick. He's just great. He's always smiling. He sounds terrific at everything he ever did. And this is a song he wrote called Mr. Walker. And to play Mr. Walker, a tune by Wes Montgomery, is our guitar ensemble. Thank you. Spain. Tom Marley on drums. Oh, and I forgot to introduce the person who worked with, started, and is developing this jazz guitar ensemble. I should have thanked him before acknowledging him. Please say hello to Brian Betts. Come on, give a bell, Brian. One big happy family here with you guys. So this next piece, who are we up to now? Herbie, there's Herbie Hancock. You know, these Herbie Hancock and Chick Corea, whenever companies that make keyboards make something new before they put it out, they always send the company Roland, and Roland, that's the name of the company that makes keyboards. So when they make things like that, they'll always send it to Chick Corea and Herbie Hancock to try out before they slap their name on it. And one time we recorded in Chick Corea's studio, and he had closet full of stuff that these companies gave him. The piano players on Maynard's band was looking at the closet and was starting to salivate. He's like, oh my God, look at all this stuff. And it's just like everything that you ever saw in a store, like 2 years later with a name on it. But before they put a name on it, these guys, they test drive. Let's see. There's her, yeah, that's what happens. There you go. Get free stuff and you get those. Anyway, this next piece, William Eaton's, by Thelonious Monk. Thelonious Monk, piano player, great composer. We love to play his music because it's just great stuff. And a lot of times jazz players will get a song and will tweak it and will add some different chords and try and make it, I don't know, not fancy, but jazz it up. But whenever you play a Thelonious Monk composition, he already did that. When we play his music, there's nothing to do to make it better because he made all the right choices. If you start to mess with it, you start to destroy his tunes. He has such great tunes. This is one of them. And he would come up with these little, fun little figures, had a great sense of humor. And this is one of them. This is called Will You Meet? And this features John and Lewis on trumpet and tenor sax. Will You Meet? By Thelonious Monk.
Oh.
I don't know how many of you get the mailing of all our events, but there's a little change that there was, I don't know if it's a problem or whatever, but our next concert, if you look at that mailing, it says it's on the 4th of April, and it's not on the 4th of April, it's on the 18th of April. So mark it, it's not the 4th, it's the 18th. 18th of April is our next concert. The 18th, not the 4th, the 18th. So come on back on the 18th. And, well, I'm gonna get the word out. It's not on the 4th, it's the 18th. It's Thursday on the 18th. Real jazz crowd, I love it. This is good to be heckled by the crowd. It feels like a real club. If, oh, and also, you're invited to this, our reception out in the lobby. You can meet Steve, and you meet Tim, and everybody. We're gonna come out there, and I think they get lobster tails or something. Or those lobster tails are those little orange crunch balls in the big can. Either one. So, let's see. Oh, okay, whoa, all right, yes, we're here. So, the next, this is Dina. She works backstage at P79, and she yells at us, even a good concert. Gee, I'm getting yelled at. Great. This is the club over there. All right. Okay, so we're over here. So, this is Voces. This is the group that is led by Chris Thomas, who runs our all the vocal choirs, and he's back there, Chris. We collaborate a lot. We do all kinds of things together. If you come to our Duke Ellington concert, you saw the 3,500 people choir. That's Chris's thing. And when we did the Sinatra thing, you saw the choir. That's Chris doing it. So we look for any opportunities we can to collaborate. It's always more fun when you do things like that. This is an arrangement of. Let's see who's up. There's Wes Montgomery. That's Wes. Let's see if they have a picture of his thumb. Let's wait for the next thing. Did you get any pictures, John, of his thumb? Let's see. He usually loops it. Now, he was great. Oh, this guy was the best. I must have thought he'd get to it. Come on. Here we go. Let's see if he's down. Ah! Oh, my clothes. It's close. Anyway, he was it. So, anyway, this is a song by Horace Silver. And Horace Silver was one of the first writers. He played piano, but he wrote a lot of things. We all play his songs. His songs are great. He was one of the first people to actually write for the rhythm section to do something. The rhythm section being the piano, bass, and drums, and maybe guitar. Songs up to a certain point were just melody and chords, and everyone would just play them. But Horace wrote things for the rhythm section to do, like they would have a break in the tune, where they would go from a swing beat to a Latin beat, something like that. But he always kind of changed it around a little bit. But he wrote some great songs. And this is going to feature, once again, Steve Weiss. Steve? Oh, there he is. Steve Weiss. And this is something that I wrote up when I was in graduate school, when I went to school at the University of Miami. And we recorded it as part of a project. Thought we would do it, and Chris was kind enough to put this group together. This is Horace Silver's Song for My Father, featuring Voces and Steve Weiss, and the rhythm section.
Was ever a man who was generous, gracious, and good.
Oh man, that's cool. Anyway, see, so that's what we wind up doing here, collaborate like that. How about a hand one more time, Kelly? Thank you. Chris Thomas. It's all him. So we're going to do another first chart by one of our students. Let's see who's up. Oh, there's Chick. Chick Corea. We've got two pianos, four pianos, six pianos. Just keep multiplying if you don't look at it. So this is a piece by Wayne Shorter, a great composer. Wayne Shorter was one of the pivotal composers. We had people who wrote great songs that we play, and we have composers that kind of changed the game, sort of tilted the axis of how we played and how we wrote. And Wayne is one of the real big influences. People study his music like they would study Duke Ellington. In fact, Wayne Shorter is kind of a lot of times compared to Duke Ellington, but just at a later time. And he wrote so many great tunes. Anyway, we're going to feature Steve, and this is a song that see this thing? Now look at this thing. See this? It's like a Moog synthesizer. It's like one of the first things they ever made. And in no time at all, this thing was outdated. So this was a. Man, those chords and all that, they laugh at that now. You know, we'll see what he has. Probably have some more toys. Sure. So, anyway, this is a song called Yes or No and by Wayne Shorter. And the arrangement is by our drummer, Tom Riley. So, come on.
The mic is yours.
What's that? So at times like this, our own boss, myself, and Professor Dennis, Maynard Ferguson, would have this to say. This is the part in the program where we talk a little bit because the bass player is a little winded. You're supposed to look tired. Ah, see, that's great. And it served us on purpose. So, thank you all very much for having me here. Please applaud yourselves. Thank you. I'd like to thank my BFF forever. That's redundant, but it's worth it. The hardest working man in show business, Dennis de Blasio! He's always so dramatic. So, we're going to play something now that was from a very cool era in music. Why was it cool? Because it was when the top band in the land, the coolest, the hippest, the Beyonce of the day, was led by a trombone player. You know, and that's how it should be, don't you think? That's what I'm saying. We should do some more of that. And he had a big band. His name was Tommy Dorsey. And this Tommy Dorsey's family is here tonight. Frank, so how cool is that? He had a big band, and some big bands had theme songs, and his theme song was romantic and pretty, just like me. Don't you agree? You do. And why not? Trombone stuff should be romantic and pretty. He needs to make you think of love, happiness, pizza, that's trombone stuff. So we're going to do that now. Aptly enough, it was called, and still is called, I'm Getting Sentimental Over You. And Tommy played it in the magnificent key of D major, not to be confused with D minor, which is the saddest of all keys. This one is a happy key. It's in D major, and it has a lot of high notes for trombone, and Tommy played it flawlessly and perfectly. And so we're going to play with the original key of D major. Here it is. And he didn't need a microphone, so I can't use one. So we're going to play now, myself in the rhythm section, Tommy Lewis's theme song. Thank you.
Thank you. help